So when you're on the phone and somebody says, I want to buy a house or sell my house, what's the first thing you should do?
We need accurate information.
You do need accurate information for sure. And to get that information from your clients, to start with, what do you need to do?
Fill out a form.
You do a needs analysis.
Bingo. Yes. And we do that. We start with that phone conversation, right? Buyer raises his hand and says, I want to buy a house. Then we don't instantly go, okay, great. Let's set an appointment so we can go look at houses. We've got some work to do, right? We have to do the qualifying questions, which are found on your buyer lead sheet in your PC toolkit in the conversations folder, okay? And then same thing with the seller. We go into the qualifying questions. We got to get to their motivation. We're not going to spend time on that today, but that's the first step in having a successful transaction. Then at the buyer's appointment, the buyer consultation and the listing appointment, we have to set expectations. Welcome. What is your name?
Andy.
Andy, nice to meet you. I haven't met you in person yet either. So forgive me for not putting faces to names. And sometimes when you don't always turn your cameras on Zoom, I can't memorize your faces to your names. That also helps. Thank you, by the way, Zoom land. Everyone has their cameras on. Love it. Okay, so setting expectations. Super important, okay? So we're not going to talk about how to do the buyer's consultation or how to do the listing appointment today. But when we get to the setting the expectations and we're writing an offer, I get questions all the time about what should we offer? We'll have you guys as agents reach out to us sometimes. What should my client offer? We can't answer that for you. You can't answer that for your client. Did you know that?
Yes.
Yeah, it's their offer, okay? They tell you what to write. You can guide them and you can help them. So let's just take, for example, let's use round numbers and say there's a house for $500,000. And this is their dream home. They want this home so bad. And they say, well, you know, I know the market's starting to, it looks like it's kind of declining and houses are staying on the market a little bit longer. So do you think I should offer $475,000? Well, let me ask you, Ross, if we offer $475,000, you're the buyer.
Sorry.
If we offer $475,000 and somebody else comes in with a higher offer and you lose out, are you going to be upset?
I'll probably be pretty upset. I like the house.
Okay. So if somebody comes in and offers $500,000, are you willing to... Or would that make you upset if you lose the house?
Yeah, because I could have paid $500,000.
Okay. So let's take it a step further. If somebody were to offer $505,000, would you be upset?
I think anywhere in the neighborhood of $500,000, I would probably be upset.
Okay.
Yeah.
So at what number? And you can continue asking this same question and get them to the number, or you can speed it along depending how the conversation is going. And you can say, so Ross, tell me what number you're comfortable paying so that if you lose the house, you're okay. But if you get it, you're also okay.
This house, my cap's probably about 520.
Okay, awesome. So we'll go ahead and write it for 520 then?
I imagine so, yes.
Okay. You don't want to risk that they are, oh, well, they can just counter me. They can, but what if somebody comes in with a higher offer and they choose not to counter, right? So it just depends on how badly your client wants the house. Just because things are staying on the market for 3 weeks now instead of one does not mean we're in a bad market. We're still in a very high seller's market currently. Okay, so this is how we help our buyers come to a decision. Then, of course, there's other things in there, right? Who pays for the home warranty? Who pays for this? Who pays for that? You have to ask the buyer if they want the seller to pay for anything. Or are they wanting to make their offer stronger by agreeing to pay for it themselves? In which case, it does not need to go on the purchase agreement. Okay, The only thing you have to say yay or nay on the purchase agreement is the home warranty, because that tells escrow what to do. If it's something that the buyer's paying for, say the buyer's gonna do their own pest report, you don't have to put it on the purchase agreement. If the buyer wants seller to pay for it, it has to go on the purchase agreement, okay? So it's really important when you're setting expectations around home warranty on both buyer and seller side. And this is something that I see not enough agents do, okay? And then the home inspection happens. I said home warranty, didn't I? I meant home inspection, I'm sorry. The home inspection happens, the report comes back, the buyer wants to ask for 5,000 things that are listed, even though there's not that many that they should be asking for. The buyer asks for a bunch of stuff, now the seller's mad because they're being unreasonable. So here's how we take care of that. So we never let that happen to begin with, is when you're setting your expectation with your buyer, you're talking to them, okay, are you going to have a home inspection? Yes, I'd like a home inspection. By the way, if they ever say no, because they don't have to have one, they should, okay? So if they ever say no and you say, well, you know, I really suggest that you do, mind you, they're not a contractor, but they can find anything that's glaring that may be of concern. So I really would recommend that you do this. Well, no, I'm okay. My brother's a whatever, I'm okay. Okay, fine. Follow up with an email stating, reiterating that conversation so you have something in writing and that it's against your advice, okay? Really important little thing there. Okay, now, when you talk to the buyer about the home inspection, you wanna let them know, okay, Mr. and Mrs. Buyer, here's the thing. When we do the home inspection, this is not a contractor, he's not gonna open walls, he's not gonna look in pipes, he's not gonna do any of that. But what he is going to do is he's going to make sure that all the plugs work. He's going to make sure that all the lights come on and off. He's going to run the AC and the heat and the water, make sure there's no leaks and drips where he can visually see. And he may find some things that are of concern. And those are things that you might want to ask the seller for. And you might not. Maybe it's something you can easily take care of or know somebody who can help you. The only thing that we're looking for in a home inspection that you might want to ask the seller to do is safety concerns, okay? So if he does a home inspection and we find that the base plate is cracked, you can take care of that yourself. It's 50 cents at Home Depot, right? We want to make sure that we're setting the expectation that they're not asking for the moon. They're asking for safety things. I've had people ask for ridiculous things and ask for everything on the report. Keep in mind, a home inspection report lists everything about the house. So part of the reason for this inspection is to educate the buyer about the house so that the buyer knows where the gas shutoff valve is, where the water shutoff is in case of an emergency. Okay, they're gonna, they're gonna be basically a good home inspector, by the way, will do the inspection, and then the last few minutes, they'll walk through the home with the client, and they'll point out where things are, how to work things, what to do. And a good home inspector, if there's an issue, and I'll just tell you the most common one that we see, you know, this outlet right here is in the bathroom, and this house was built before GFIs were code. And so I would recommend that at some point in the future, you change that to a GFI outlet. That's a good home inspector. That's one you want to work with. If they say, you know, this house was built before GFI was up to code, this isn't a GFI, so you need to ask the seller to put a GFI in here. That's not a good home inspector. Fire them and don't use them again. The home inspector should never, ever, ever, and I've had this happen and I've fired home inspectors. The home inspector should never tell a buyer what they should and shouldn't ask a seller for. It's none of their business. They are a third party person that knows nothing about your transaction. If your buyer got the deal of the century and shouldn't ask for a red penny, don't do it, right? They don't know that. If your buyer is paying through the nose because they really wanted that house, okay, maybe they can ask for a couple things because they're getting way more than they thought they were getting. Home inspectors don't know that and they don't need to. So never let a home inspector tell your buyers what to ask for. That is key. Okay, and setting expectations with your buyer. Okay, any questions about that? Okay, so on the flip side of that, you also have to set expectations with your seller because, okay, Mr. Seller, the buyers are gonna have their home inspection Thursday at 3 o'clock. And so just be prepared. They may find some things that they wanna ask for repairs for. So I just wanna alert you to that. And if they do, I'll make sure and let you know. Now you won't be required to do any repairs, but if it is a true safety concern and it's not a big deal, then we might really wanna consider doing that. So when you prepare them ahead of time, it's not a shock. And then it doesn't become a pain point in your transaction. Okay, see the benefit of that? Versus if you never say anything to anyone, so buyer thinks that, oh my gosh, it's on the report, I gotta ask for it. And believe me, if you don't set the expectation, that's what they think. And then a seller's like, wait a minute, I just went down $5,000 on what I asked. I shouldn't have to pay for anything. It happens all the time. Did you experience any of that?
With a window, yes. Finally, a credit occurred for the window, but it was a bone of contention with the seller, but the window frame was clearly busted. I mean, you could see.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
But, and you had the buyer, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So if the list agent does their job in setting expectations, which they often don't, by the way, that's why we try to teach you how to do things the best practice way. Because there's a lot of agents out there that don't. They just take the listing, they get the offer accepted, they go, they just deal with things as they come. But we want to coach you and train you to handle things before they happen so they don't have to happen. That's the best way to do it. And that's how you're giving your client a fiduciary service, which is what we owe them, right? Okay.
I will say the selling agent was very beneficial in getting the credit.
Oh, good.
The seller was just a very difficult personality.
And you're going to have that. You're going to have that. Yes. And there's just not much we can do about that, right? But how we handle it makes or breaks how that circumstance works out. So we wanted, there's the bold lock, keep your emotions between the lines. If our client is getting emotional during the transaction, we cannot. We have to stay right here, right? Because one party's up here, one party's down here. That's why this party's up here all upset. We have to stay here. That's our job, is to keep things in check. Okay? Okay. So setting expectations is the key to having smooth transactions. Every transaction is different, and every transaction is going to have its bumps and bruises, likely. And if you ever have one that doesn't, I've actually had a couple of them. It's like really cool. You almost feel like I'm forgetting something. Wait, this was too easy. But look at the bumps and bruises through the transactions like a learning experience. It's a great education. It's an education on negotiations. It's an education on things that we don't know. To this day, I've been doing this 25 years, and to this day, we'll still have things come up that I've never heard of or have never had happen before. And so we have to figure it out together. It's a constant learning. It's just things are different. Okay, so that I wanted to really make sure that we covered today, that we set the expectations. Now, something I want to show you, and then we'll go through the timeline of a transaction. Let me pull up a document from the PC Toolkit, by the way. So if you have your computers, you're welcome to pull it up as well, but I'll share the screen here. And let me just, there we go. So in your PC Toolkit, there toward the bottom, if you have it in the list, there's a transaction tools folder. And in that, I actually recently went through this and made sure that it was all up to date because we had some old stuff on there we discovered recently. So let me share the screen now. This is gonna be amazingly helpful for you, whatever your transaction is, okay? So we have the pre-listing checklist. So this is something that you would do prior to getting a listing. All of these things are here for you to help you know what you need to do prior to a listing. Creating a new listing in a listing agreement in zip forms or in DocuSign through command, however you choose to do that. Scheduling your appointment. It's really good to look up in the MLS and see if there was already a listing in there. You could get a lot of information from there. However, be careful. You still are responsible to verify that information is correct. Find out if there's any point of sale requirements, because each city can be different. Each county can be different. For instance, in Tulare County, there's no point of sale requirements in Visalia, but there are in Tulare if it's in a certain area of Tulare. So always find that out, okay? And that's something that you're going to ask. You can call the city, you can call the county. That's not information we're necessarily going to have for you, because we can't memorize what every city does and what they add and all that. So make sure you do your due diligence there.
I'm sorry, Jodi. Point of sale, what is that?
So point of sale is by the time the transaction closes, something has to be done. The example that I can give you is in Tulare, there's an area of that now city that used to be county, and they incorporated it into the city. And so a lot of those homes were on not on city sewer. So when it sells, before close of escrow, seller is responsible to connect it to the city sewer. So, and that has to be done. Okay. For instance, down here you have, I know some areas, it's probably LA at large, but you have the water conserving things here. Yes. So for instance, if you have a toilet in a house that is not a low flow toilet, before escrow closes, it has to be changed to a low flow toilet, because there's certain things that have to be done at point of sale or by close of escrow. Good question.
So if there's a certain disclosure, would our TC know about it generally? Like, for example, Santa Clarita, for some strange reason, I only know this because of a sale of my daughter's in the past. They pull in an Antelope Valley disclosure, even though they're not, it's not even close to Antelope. I mean, it's adjacent, but it's not part of the Antelope Valley. How would we know about those type of things?
So the TCs might, but if it's not, if it's in an area that they don't often do, they may not, but you can certainly ask. Your TCs are going to be a huge help to you through your transaction, by the way. And when you have a specific to the transaction question, I'm going to recommend that you go there first. Okay. We're happy to help. Don't misunderstand, but they're in it with you. We're not in the transaction with you. So we can coach you what to do to get it, through it, after it, all that good stuff and building your business, but they're in it with you. So make sure you go to them first, and they might be able to help you find out that information or direct you to where you can find it out.
So I have a listing coming up there next month, and I would have never known of it. It's not even named Santa Clara. It's named Antelope Valley Disclosure. So I would have never known to even think about that.
Right. The other thing to do, whenever something's in question, reach out to the broker. Okay. And in this case, Audrey would be a wealth of information for you for here. Troy and CB for the other market centers. Doug and, I don't think we have Ventura on here right now, but Doug and Bob and Ventura. Reach out to your brokers, because your brokers do have to know that stuff. Now, if it's an area that is they never really work in, they may have to find out too. But you can also call the local MLS or board office, and they should know. Good question.
So when that point of sale is listed in
Santa Clarita,
no,
or anywhere
in disclosures. They should be listed in disclosures, right? All the items listed in point of sale, they should be.
So most of the market centers all have local to that area's disclosures. Right. So, and that's why you have individual market center folders in your PC toolkit, because for instance, in Tulare County, there's an oak tree disclosure. In the city of Visalia, you can't even pull a leaf off a tree without it being a big deal. The tree could fall on your car. The tree could be coming up from the ground causing pipe problems. You can't take it upon yourself to fix it. You've got to go through the city, and it's an act of Congress, let me tell you. But if you're not in the city of Visalia, you can do whatever you want to an oak tree. My son's a caretaker of an oak tree preserve, and he can, you know, if the trail is where it's blocking people, he can cut it down. Like, really? So I didn't even know that I thought because it was the preserve that was also protected.
I don't think in LA you can tell them.
Yes.
Whatever is listed in disclosure, is that sufficient for us to just consider disclosure rather than point of sale? Or is it a separate item that I should
know? It's your responsibility to know for that location where that home is located what needs to be done. So if in doubt, ask your broker, ask the local board office, okay? Call the city, call the county. Okay, it's impossible for us to tell you every little nuance of every place, but you have resources to find out. So just make sure that you do know any point of sale requirements for where your home is, okay? Obtain a property profile from the title company. Okay, that's really important. That's gonna give you information on the property. Okay, verify that information with the seller, by the way. The county's known to be wrong once in a while. Preparing seller net sheets, CMA. These are the two things you should always take to a listing appointment. It's up to you what you do, what you take and how you do your presentation. But those two things are very important for your conversation there, okay? Obtain their mortgage statement, prepare a listing agreement, or presentation rather, and put them into command as if they're not already in there. And if they are, create an opportunity for them. Okay. So, and we're not going to go through line by line because we'd be here all day. you can go through these on your own. But I do want you to know that once you get a listing, now there's a lot of things that you need to do, okay? Including pictures and scheduling open houses and all that sort of thing. But we're going to focus today more on the transaction. So you'll notice there's four tabs on this. So note that there's all four tabs down here. So a seller closing checklist, a buyer closing checklist. Those two checklists are pretty close to the same, but let's just focus on the buyer one right now. So once you get a signed contract, you need to get it to your TC within 24 hours. She will open escrow for you, okay? If you have the seller, if you have the buyer, you guys all know this, the listing agent is typically who opens escrow, okay? Doesn't mean you as a buyer's agent can't, however, never do it on your own. Have communication with the list agent, and if they're okay with that, that's fine. But it's the listing agent's responsibility to open escrow, okay? Your TC is gonna help you with a lot of the things on this list, but there's a lot of things that you need to be aware of. Making sure that everything is signed, the TC is going to help you with that. That earnest money deposit gets taken to escrow. How long does your buyer have to do that?
3 days.
3 days. Yes, 3 days. And if day three comes and it's not there, don't panic. Okay, communicate. That's another key thing. So, what first key is expectations, right? And I would argue these are both number one, expectations. And second is communication. Always communicate, okay? Always communicate with the other side. If something goes wrong and buyer can't get the earnest money deposit there because they ran late or something happened or they're taking it out of their 401k, so it's taking an extra 2 days, none of that's a problem as long as you communicate it, okay? The deal's not gonna fall out, nothing's gonna happen, just communicate it. Non-communication is when the problems happen, okay? Okay, as a buyer, you're gonna wanna make sure, and your TC can do this as well, but you're gonna wanna make sure that all the documents get to the lender right away so that they can start the lending process, order the appraisal, and all that good stuff, because we wanna get that done within the inspection period, okay? Unless you change it on the contract, how long is your inspection period?
17 days?
17 days, yes. So during that time, you're doing, well, let me back up one step first. How long does the seller have to get the buyer the disclosures?
3 days.
Yeah.
5 days.
1 week.
Seven days.
7 days. Very good. So if you're the buyer, and 7 days is up and you don't have the disclosures, don't be mean, okay? simply call the other side and say, hey, you know, our disclosures were due today or yesterday or whatever, or tomorrow, and we haven't received them yet. I just want to make sure that you sent them, or, you know, maybe you went to spam, let's check your spam folder. If you're emailing somebody for the first time, that happens. But communicate, okay? Don't get upset about things, communicate.
And with me, that did move slow from the seller. So it was very helpful where the TC just emailed the other TC just as a reminder.
Yes.
And then instead of picking up the phone and getting upset, that got the disclosures.
Absolutely.
Still took a couple more days, but at least it got it moving.
Yeah. And the point is that the buyer needs enough time to review them. If it takes 9 days to get them, it's not the end of the world, guys, right? Especially if it's within your inspection period. That's the key thing. But just keep things moving along and keep communication. There are times when something goes into escrow at a bad time for the seller, they forgot to get a document signed, and so they got to get it signed. And it takes an extra day or two. Just be reasonable, right? Because if you forgot to do something, you wouldn't want the agent on the other end yelling at you because you forgot something. Just be reasonable. Okay, so moving back to the inspection period, we have 17 days. So this is where, if you have the buyer and the buyer is paying for the inspection, as the buyer's agent, it's your responsibility to set those up. You can ask the buyer if there's anyone in particular they want to use, and then you should have a list of people, which we are going to reach out and compile and put some things in the toolkit for you in the near future. Everybody's different at what they have. I had one for Tulare County because I know who I like to use. I don't know the people in the other areas, so I have to trust that people are giving me good recommendations, because I typically won't recommend if I don't have personal experience.
Jodi.
Uh-huh.
I'm sorry, I have a quick question about the inspection. Sometimes when you're showing homes, sometimes the inspection's already done. If the inspection is not done, is it typical that the buyer pays for the inspection?
Yes, so the home inspection, the buyer usually pays for. That's standard in our industry. Any other inspections, the buyer can pay for or ask the seller to pay for. But the home inspection is typically the buyer's responsibility. Sometimes a seller will already have had a home inspection done and it'll be on file, or it could be on file because of an escrow that fell out prior to this one. Okay, so then it's up to your buyer if they're okay with that report or if they want one of their own. Because if they didn't choose the person or you didn't help them choose, it would be up to the buyer. They can still do their own, but they don't necessarily have to, especially if it was done by a reputable inspector. Good question though. Okay, so as we go through the inspection period, if your buyer's paying for it, it's the buyer's agent's responsibility to make it happen. If the seller's paying for it, it's the seller's agent's responsibility to make it happen. Okay, and then here's something really key. And here's another reason why sometimes disclosures might take a couple extra days. If in sending them, they discovered a signature missing or a page missing or something, and they're getting that, they may want to take an extra day, and I give it to them. Here's why. You don't want to have this packet of things to have your client sign. Oh, now here's another one for you to sign. Oh, and they forgot this 3 days later, so here's another one for you to sign. Get it all together and all at once, okay? The same thing when you're having inspections done. No matter who's paying for the inspections, buyer or seller, don't do a request for repairs until you have all reports available, including the appraisal. Okay, because we're only going to go to the will once. Okay, we only want to ask the seller one time for everything. Because how horrible would it be if buyer and seller agree on the home inspection report and roof, whatever, and we come to an agreement and sellers are pretty tapped out. Now the appraiser goes out there and there's issues that have to be taken care of, because the things that the appraiser notes are not options if the buyer wants the loan. Okay, doesn't mean seller has to pay for them, but they're not options. They have to be done, okay? On that note, please make sure if you take a listing, when you're at the listing appointment, make sure that there is a working smoke detector, CO2 detectors, right? CO detectors. And that the water heater is double strapped or anchored braced somehow to the wall. Because an appraiser will call that out, that will have to be fixed, And it's going to cost $150 for them to go back out and verify that the strap got put on or that the smoke detector battery was changed or whatever the case may be, which is like a cheap item to fix, right? So please make sure. I know some agents keep extra ones in the back of their car. So if they go do their Avid or they're there with the home inspector, the appraiser hasn't been there yet, they'll just throw it up there. So don't cost your buyers more money by not verifying that, because those are three things that are a given, okay? Something else that's a given, particularly on an FHA loan, is any peeling or bare wood will have to be painted. So if you notice that in showing the home, you might want to talk to the list agent about that. Okay. So once you have all of your reports, that's when you will create your request for repairs if the buyer wants you to. The buyer does not have to ask for repairs, okay? They can, but they don't have to. So keep that in mind, because we get asked all the time, what should they ask for? What should they be putting all this? I've had people cut and paste the summary section and put it onto the request for repairs. That's not what we do.
When it comes to FHA or VA, when you're doing the listing, the seller can say, I don't want to go down that route, correct?
Yeah.
That's what I thought.
Yeah, because there are certain things that are would be required with those. Typically, they don't, but...
But they can.
Well, there was a time in the last couple of years they did, yeah. Just because of the craziness of the market. We won't be hearing that very often anymore. But good question. Okay, once the request for repairs is done, you send it to your buyer to sign, you send it to the list agent, then we have a new negotiation, okay? So, seller can agree to all repairs, agree to some of the repairs, agree to none of the repairs, or agree to give a credit. Here's the caution on credit. Every loan is only allowed to have so much credit from the seller. So if you have a situation where you've already asked for seller to pay closing costs, which for a while we weren't doing, but we're starting to see that again, depending on the loan, it's typically 3-3.5%. Ask your lender that. Don't ask us, because we don't know all the loan programs and the details of every single one that all the lenders have, right? So if they're, say they're already at 3% and the that's their limit, then the seller cannot credit for repairs. Because here's the thing. Let's say there's no credits and they want to credit them $5,000 for the repairs, and that should take care of it. Maybe the buyer wants to do their own repairs, which is a really great way to negotiate this, by the way. As long as the credit's not used up, then you do an addendum that says seller to credit buyer X dollars toward prepaids and or closing costs. Notice I didn't say repairs. Lender will not allow that. Lenders know this is how it works. We all know this is how it works. You cannot say for repairs. It has
to be. Can you say that verbiage one more time?
Seller agrees to pay X dollars for buyers, prepaids, and or closing costs. Totally fine. But that addendum does have to be done. So on the request for repairs, they can mark credit and they can put how much. But you have to follow that up with an addendum. Here's the thing. The lender never sees the request for repairs or the response. They just need the addendum instructing what to do. Okay. So while we're on that discussion, two things that I want to mention, because you have one other potential new negotiation point. So we'll talk about that first, and then remind me if my brain goes south, remind me pest inspection. Okay. So, with an appraisal, if an appraisal comes in low, don't panic, okay? But if an appraisal comes in low, that is a new negotiation. The options are seller agrees to the lower amount, seller doesn't agree to the lower amount and stands firm, or seller and buyer meet in the middle. So that also means that if seller doesn't agree, buyer can walk, okay? And whatever agreement is made, you need to do it on an addendum. Okay. Always negotiate, guys. Don't ever assume. Don't get all, oh my gosh, my client this. Negotiate. Okay, this is where learning how to negotiate really comes into play, because it's not necessarily done once you're in escrow. There's a couple points where it can happen again. Okay, back to the pest inspection and loans. This is something super important to know. Depending on what area you live in, sometimes people do pest inspections up front. It's not common in most places though. And if you're asking the seller for a pest inspection, number one, ask for a full clearance. I see all the time, seller to pay for pest inspection and section one clearance. Okay, a lender requires a full clearance if they see a pest inspection on the purchase agreement, not just section one. So if you're okay with section one, you can put that on the purchase agreement that way, and seller's agreeing to that, but you're gonna need an addendum, because you're gonna have to take the pest inspection off of the purchase agreement, because the lender cannot see that it's not a full clearance.
I have a question, Jodi. Okay, so you said ask for full clearance of the pest report section one. If there's section two, which is items that may be a problem but aren't currently a problem, how is that covered under full clearance? Because usually section two is something that you know, the buyer takes care of, right?
Full clearance is both section one and section two.
I'm sorry?
A full clearance is both section one and section two.
Okay, so that would mean that the seller would do both of it, correct. All of it. Okay.
Correct. But because of what you just said, Jennifer, we hear that a lot. We hear, buyer doesn't really care about this, so we're not going to ask for section two. If it's on the purchase agreement, seller has to do a full clearance, both section one and section two.
Okay. And you suggest we do write that, we ask for full clearance. What if the agent, that say that I'm representing the buyer, what if the seller's agent comes back and says everything I just said to you?
Then we
don't have full clearance?
Then you can do that, but here's what happens. Once the pest inspection's done, once the repairs are negotiated and seller agrees to pay a portion of them, and buyer's okay with that, now we do an addendum stating, seller and buyer agree to remove pest inspection from the purchase agreement. So you negotiate it on the request for repairs and the response, and then you remove it from the contract. Because if it's on the contract, the lender will require a full clearance. So here's the thing. A lot of times, I will suggest that the buyer, do the pest inspection, because it's under $100 typically. And if there's an issue, it can be addressed on a request for repairs. A lender never sees it and it's not an issue. Now, with a VA loan, you don't have that option. It has to be on there. It does not have to be on there for anything else that I'm aware of, unless they have some special niche program that I don't know about. So let me put that disclaimer out there.
Okay. Now, I have one other quick question. Let's say that the seller, just as you had with the home inspections earlier, you had, say, Mr. and Mrs. Seller that did all the inspections. So they have the pest inspection as well. So leaving that up to the buyer to get a second pest inspection. Can you ask for, obviously you can ask for all of that up front when you're writing the offer, or even before you wrote the offer, you can ask the listing agent for the reports. So you would know what would be.
And really, if it's a reputable pest company and the report is still within its time limit, there's no reason to get a second one.
Okay.
There's no reason for the buyer to do that, because most of the time it's going to be a reputable pest inspection company that's going to do that. They have law requirements and things like that. That when it comes to home inspectors are not regulated by the state of California, believe it or not. So there's a lot of disreputable home inspectors out there. That's why it matters who did the report, the inspection on file.
Right.
Okay, so that's the difference there.
Okay.
So for a VA or FHA, do they have to, like if you have a pest inspection, I'm thinking about the house I'm doing, do they have to be known or with the VA or the FHA to be reputable? Do they have to be
licensed?
Yeah, they just have to be a license. Yeah.
They just have to be just licensed.
Yeah, I don't, I'm not aware of like their
they don't
being
have a list that you're aware of.
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay.
I've never looked at one and had issue. I just put who I use and
okay.
been fine. Good question though. Okay. So once we have the all of the repairs firmed up and we've negotiated however we've negotiated it, then really at this point, guys, it's pretty much a waiting game. You're waiting for the calendar to tick away, right? But here's the thing, don't lose contact and communication with your clients and with the other side. Remember, every time something happens, communicate what's next and when. Okay, if you've got a month left before closing, because maybe it was a longer escrow, you're not going to be calling them every day with an update. You're not going to have an update every day, right? And that's okay, but you need to know, okay, great, we have all of our requests for repairs firmed up, so we'll see to it that those are completed. And as soon as we know they're completed, we'll do a walkthrough and we'll make sure everything is as it should be. The best time to do the walkthrough for to check the repairs and before close of escrow, 5 days before close of escrow is when you want to do your final walkthrough. It doesn't have to be exactly five. No, it could be six, it could be four, it could be three. Never, ever, ever let a transaction record without having done a final walkthrough unless your buyer doesn't want to and they check the box that they're not going to and make sure that's in writing, okay? Because what they're looking for is one, that the repairs that were agreed to are done, which by the way, you should be confirming along the way with the other side, unless they're your responsibility. And then you're also looking to make sure that the house is in the same condition it was when you went into escrow. So nobody drove through the street and threw a rock in a window or something, right? So you just wanna make sure it's in the proper condition. So set the expectation that that's 5 days before escrow. The other expectation you need to set is the closing process is a 3-day process, okay? So day one, buyer signs loan docs. Day two, lender funds. Day three, escrow records. Now, can that happen in 1 or 2 days? It can, and it does quite often. Never set that expectation. Okay, always set the expectation that it's a 3-day process, and if it gets done faster, great. Okay, because it will happen, and I've had it happen many times. The loan docs are signed, and the funder goes to fund, and at the 11th hour, something was missing, and they need this before they can fund. Now, funding's cutting off, so it's not going to fund until the next day. Okay, always set the expectation, which also, by the way, when you write a purchase agreement, is why you should never put 30 days, 45 days, 60 days for escrow. You should put a date that you want it to close. And if you want a 30-day escrow, make it about 35-ish days out, right? Because we need time to negotiate this to open escrow. And always have it in the middle of the week, unless it's the Wednesday before Thanksgiving, because that's essentially Friday. So never have it close on a Friday, never have it close on the last day of the month. That is when escrow is their busiest. That is where things can go wrong. That is where it might not record if an issue comes up. And if you've got buyer in a moving van ready to go in and now you tell them you can't give them keys till we record on Monday, you got an upset buyer. Okay, so avoid that by making sure that you're closing in the middle of the week. They don't have to move in when it closes, but that gives you a couple of days leeway if something goes wrong. Because it does happen a lot, believe me. So pad that, okay? So 3-day closing process, buyer signs, buyer lender funds, escrow records. Your escrow is not closed and you may not give keys to the buyer until you get confirmation from escrow that it's on record or it's recorded, however they tell you. You will get, right after the loan funds, you'll get congratulations on the close of escrow. We've funded your loan, not closed.
The only one you looked at to know you closed is from escrow recording. Okay, because when the lender funds, they are done with it. So as far as they're concerned, congratulations, we're done. And I actually had an agent about 4 years ago go give keys to somebody because of that. So now I make sure that we talk about that. and because she had to go get keys back. That was cool. Yeah, that was not cool. And they were already out having drinks celebrating. Yeah, and we're frantically trying to get a hold of her. So we're like, and it was weird because she walked into group coaching and she's like, oh, I'm so sorry. I can't stay today. I got to go give keys to my buyer. Number one, I'm like, you don't schedule that during group coaching. Because this is where you're learning to help people more, right? So schedule it before or after. Then number two, I was like, I thought it was closing till tomorrow. Oh, no, no, it closed today. Okay. And then I had people calling. And then we had to frantically get a hold of her. Took us a couple hours to get a hold of her. I don't think she ever took the keys back. I think she let it go in hopes nothing would go wrong. Don't ever do that. Because it's still the seller's possession. It's still the seller's insurance. If anything goes wrong. Oh, and by the way, you'll get asked this question. Well, we're not going to be able to close on time, and everybody's okay with that. But my buyer, can they move the stuff into the garage? No. Can they? Yeah. Can you negotiate that? Yeah. Don't. That's not a good thing. They can move it into a moving truck and sit it somewhere. So that is contract to close in a nutshell. We only had an hour to go over a lot of stuff. But the key things that I wanted to get through today were expectations, communication, key points through the process. So since we have about 10 minutes left, what questions do any of you have?
Jodi, I was wondering about your negotiations for repairs again. So, and I'm sorry, I've put in two, I've represented two buyers, but we have not won the home or gotten our contract agreed upon. So I'm working with them still. So I want to make sure I'm prepared and correct. So when we get the home inspection and we're negotiating still on what you want to be fixed, but then we can get an appraisal and then renegotiate again, correct?
So the appraisal should be happening during the inspection time, and you shouldn't ever do a request for repairs until the appraisal is back, along with all the other inspections.
Okay, so you want us to wait both of them.
Yes, because you only want to do one request for repairs. So you wait for every report that you're having done, because sometimes it's simply appraisal home inspection, or it could be appraisal home inspection pest, but depending on the home, it could be a roof inspection, a pool inspection, a this and that, a septic, a well, whatever, right? So any inspections you're doing, never do a request for repairs until all inspections are back. So here's the thing too, and this is another panic point for some people. Oh my gosh, it's day 17. I have to get in my request for repairs today, but I don't have the appraisal back yet. That's okay. Call the list agent, let them know. The appraiser, we're not going to have the appraisal back until this time, so I need to do an extension, and then you can have your TC do an extension of time for that. Don't do two just because you didn't get it back on time, okay? You're going to wait till you have everything, even if it means you have to do an extension. Did all that make sense?
Yeah, Jodi, I have a question. So I've been out of the industry for a few years. And when you say appraisal and the request for repairs after the appraisal, are the appraisers now calling out smoke detectors and carbon monoxide? That's kind of a given, but are the appraisers calling out more items as well?
If it's an FHA appraisal or a VA appraisal, yes, there are certain things they're looking for. For instance, peeling or paint, exposed wood. I've seen different odd things. I had one recently, I can't remember what it was, but it was something I've never seen an appraiser ask for. And I'm like, really? Okay. We got it fixed. But anyway, yes. So okay. That's why we have to wait for that appraisal, wait for everything. We're only going to the well once.
Okay.
One thing I want to add before we're done with this discussion, though, is once you hand the keys over or you congratulate the seller, you give them your closing gift, and yay, remember, guys, we're in this business to have clients for life. So make sure that you're putting them on a follow-up campaign. If you have a buyer, call them in 2 weeks. How are things going? I know you were going to put new carpet in that master bedroom. Did you get that taken care of? I'd love to see a picture when it's done. You know, call them in 1 month and double check on them. Then call them in 90 days. Call them like every 3 months throughout the year. And at the year mark, happy home anniversary. How exciting, your first year in your new home, right? If it's an investor, it doesn't matter. You might not say happy home anniversary, but you're going to check on things. How's the repairs coming, right? For getting it rented, do you have any prospects for renters? If it's a seller, hey, are you getting settled in your new home, right? So make sure that you are creating clients for life. Get them in command. Put them on with the touches, the neighborhood nurtures, right? The home searches and the quarterly call plan. Because you want them to use you again, okay? And I've had many clients call me back 3 years later. They're moving. I had one move out of the country that hadn't been in their home very long. I had one move across country to be with her grandkids, and she'd only been in her house a year and a half. Happens all the time. Create clients for life. Okay. Any last questions, thoughts, comments, ahas? All right, guys. Well, it's still great to see everybody in the room. Central Coast, I'm going to see you on Saturday. So excited to spend the day with you in the Pismo Beach office. And